glomerular fever. And what I mind in particular is not just looking at causes of fever, but also looking at tools that can be implemented to improve the management of febrile illness. So over to you, Valerie.
Thank you, Yoel. Thank you very much for inviting me in this place that is not very far from where we work. So it's so easy to come, and we are really happy to participate. So I was asked to try to look at the end, what are really the causes of fever we should be looking at. There are so many pathogens. Once I tried to list them, and I ended up with 153 at least that can cause fever. Should we look for each of them one by one? No, obviously this is not feasible. So we have to have criteria to decide which should be diagnosed because of several reasons, and which are the most important and contribute mostly, obviously, to mortality. So just to set the scene, as you know, children dying still from fevers, and I do not have accurate numbers. It's very difficult to calculate, no trend, but we feel that the drop in the number of cases of fever is not proportional to the number of antibiotics that are prescribed. The number of antibiotics have tripled very recently in low and middle income countries, from 8 to 18 billion daily doses. So why all these antibiotics have not the impact that we expect? There are many reasons, but one of the main reasons is that, in fact, many of these fevers are not due to bacteria, as we saw before with Blaise's presentation. They are mostly due to viral disease, and this does not respond, obviously, to antibiotics. It's more pronounced in children than in adults, but it's true probably in both populations. The other reason why we do not manage really to decrease mortality is that we give the wrong class of antibiotic at the wrong dosage for a wrong duration in many cases. Wrong class, for example, clinicians we see in the field, they do not really know which antibiotic work on what, so they tend to give, for example, amoxicillin for an abdominal infection, and this will obviously not work. Or they don't know that pneumococcus has become completely resistant to cotrimoxazole, so it will basically not work. So when they give cotrimoxazole, they think that they cure the patient. In fact, it's just because it was due to a virus. Another example about the dosage, often they prescribe amoxicillin at the normal dosage of 40 milligrams per kilo instead of 90 milligrams per kilo for pneumonia. So it's systematically underdosed. Although there are very clear guidelines from WHO, they tend to always prescribe less than would be required. And duration, because patients tend to stop prematurely because they feel better, and they always think about the next time they will be sick, so they want to save medicine, so maybe universal health coverage could really help here. But there is another, probably more important reason than the two I just mentioned, is that we have a very narrow view of the problem. We always think in terms of, oh, fever, we have to look for a pathogen because we have to treat it with antimicrobial. And when you read that in papers, to treat the pathogen. In fact, we don't want to treat the pathogen, we want to kill it. So we want to kill it, the pathogen, without killing the patient and curing the patient. So that's completely different. It's a completely different story, in fact. The pathogen and antimicrobial are only at the end of the problem. Because first you need a pathogen that does an infection, and this is not always the case. You have, for example, patients that can have a pathogen, carry meningococcus. Nothing will happen as long as there is not a damage to the mucosa or the skin that we allow the bacteria to enter, like for meningitis. And here, I will show you later what type of management are essential to tackle all these other reasons why patients will not do well with an infection. Infection still does not mean disease. You are infected with many things without even knowing. And suddenly, because you have a low immunity, you have comorbidities, you will develop a disease. So here the patient, the host, is absolutely essential. And the main reason we see for low immunity is malnutrition in children, HIV mainly in adults, diabetes, pregnancy also. So these factors are extremely important to be looking at when managing a febrile patient. And then some disease in some patients will be mild, but in others, for several reasons, it will become a severe disease. Because of age, neonates have to be taken care of differently than an older child. Genetic factors, on this we cannot do much. And what we really see now, for example, in Tanzania where we work, is that this patient can get any type of disease. What really matters is what will make them die at the end of the day is these comorbidities. And the hospital, you systematically see, this child is malnourished, severely malnourished, has a cardiac malformation. This is what made him die of a stupid RSV virus. So these comorbidities are also a very strong reason for not doing well when having fever. And at the other side of the problem, antimicrobial is one piece of the management that we have to do in this patient. We need to provide them a lot of non-antimicrobial treatment that probably will make them survive much more than the antibiotic itself, like oxygen for bronchiolitis in a small child. And management also does not necessarily mean that you will manage to cure the patient. You have to do more. You have to do supportive measures immediately when the child or the adult comes with a severe disease, and also for long-term prevention of consequences. So what really matters here is not the pathogen and the antimicrobial, as you can see. It's the patient that we want to cure. And this is why when we look at intervention to improve management of febrile patients, we should really take as outcome measure, not the diagnosis itself. But because if we do that, it means we focus only on this part of the game and we completely miss all the rest. This is why we really have to look at clinical outcome of patient. Clinical outcome means cure rate, for example, and also complications like secondary hospitalization, sequelae, and death. So if we do nothing, if we have no lab test, all these sophisticated things we want to bring in, before this time, what were we doing? What did we manage to get as a cure rate, for example? So on the left is a comparing intervention at the health facility level and on the right at the community level, so even milder disease. You see at the health facility, doing basically almost nothing, you get already a very high cure rate because most of these patients have very mild disease. So routine management is 95% cure rate. If we try to do better by implementing an NMCI-based algorithm, we get 96. And with an adapted version of IMCI, trying really to look at each of these small pieces of the puzzle that are too difficult to put in a paper version, but that you manage to put in an electronic version of the algorithm, you can even improve slightly better to 98. But probably we will not manage to go higher than that. We will always have a few children that will fail. And at community level is even better, let's say. Whatever you do, they get cured. So that's not the problem. The problem is really how to pick up these very few patients that will need to be referred, that are at risk of dying or having complications. So coming back to these different factors that will matter for patient cure, an example about the local damage. In IMCI, there are very basic clinical tests and treatment that are promoted that make the world difference, probably much more than adding an antibiotic. Like for all these children with cough, just giving them tea and honey will smooth the mucosa and maybe avoid to go for a bacterial pneumonia. For low immunity, in adults we have seen before, they are mostly HIV positive. So you have to start to look at this I mean, presently, adults arriving to a health facility with a fever episode are basically never tested for HIV, while it will be one of the first tests to do, and more than HIV, to know if they are immunosuppressed based on CD4 count. Malnutrition and hypoglycemia are also very important comorbidities, and we have action. We can give them specific treatment. So in the EPOCT algorithm, we were measuring hypoglycemia and immediately giving them sugar. Malnutrition needs a specific management. Maybe they need more antibiotics than the other children. Measles, vitamin A, so this is all already included in IMCI. Now for comorbidities. What we miss are some important comorbidities that we have heard about with David maybe yesterday, like the sickle cell disease. We don't speak much about that. And when I was on a call with the Gates Foundation for another project, suddenly they said, in fact, do you work on sickle cell? We recently discovered that this is a big problem. So suddenly there are things popping up like that. Say, what do you do for sickle cell? Okay, in fact, by chance, we were working with our hematologist in Lausanne to try to have a very simple rapid test. So because these children or patients need a specific management. Low weight for high needs referral. We have seen all this cardiac malformation that we miss, this cerebral palsy. These children, these are the children who will die. Respiratory distress, how to detect that? Because children then need salbutamol or to be referred for oxygen. And a general host distress, when the patient gets severe, we need to refer and give specific supportive treatment to these patients. An example of non-antimicrobial treatment that are essential, anemia, we have seen before, is one of the most important clinical predictor of bacterial disease, severe disease. So we have to look for anemia. Palmar paler is probably not enough to detect them, so we probably need a test here. Because transfusion, iron makes the difference. Respiratory symptoms, why do IMCI say put lemon in the tea? Because it's vitamin C, and this is how I treat my children all the time, is juice, orange juice every morning as soon as they have a virus. And this will probably really help them much more than an antibiotic. Diarrhea, no antibiotic. But last time I went to a small health facility in northern Tanzania, in West, 95% of children with diarrhea were receiving an antibiotic, and none of them were receiving zinc. I mean, how is that possible 30 years after beginning of IMCI? I mean, we cannot continue like that. Some new ideas like vomiting, we were giving ondansetron in EPOCT to stop the vomiting. So we have to work around the pathogen, not looking just at the pathogen. For some of these comorbidities, cofactors, we need tests. We might have tests. We need tests. I mean, presently, we do not too bad with symptoms and signs. If in the future we want to bring tests, maybe before jumping on a multiplex, complex thing for detecting all pathogens, maybe we should look for this type of test. Like host distress, we are using presently a cardiac rate counter because it's included in the oximeter. But here we want something better, like one of your tests, Kevin, that could detect either in adults, we could see that STREM1 was a good predictor of mortality, Eng1, Eng2, we need to develop rapid tests based on these host factors. For respiratory distress, what we use presently is oximeter, respiratory counter mostly manually. But could we imagine in the future to have a chest picture analysis? You take a picture or small video of the chest of the child, and this will help health worker to detect chest in drawing, for example. For anemia, we have included the hemoglobinometer, but we would really like to have a non-invasive test. This might be possible. For malnutrition, it takes time to health worker. They have to measure the arm circumference. They have to weight the child, measure the child. Could we have a full body picture analyzer? You just take a picture of the child that can tell you if there is malnutrition. We have a big engineering school next door in Lausanne that are working the whole day on machine learning for recognition of picture for the FBI. And I went to them, could you maybe work on recognition of malnutrition rather than face for FBI? Would you be interested? And they are interested because they know health is a big topic. So maybe in the future we can just take a picture of the child. Hypoglycemia, we would need something like a detector in the sweating that tells us if the child is strongly hypoglycemic or the patient. And for AIDS, we have included the HIV rapid test, but what we would really need is a semi-quantitative CD4 rapid test, and we do not have that. A very simple test that can tell us below 200 CD4 count, okay, that completely changed the management of the patient. I have to start to look for opportunistic diseases. And finally, sickle cell disease, there is a rapid test, quite expensive, $20 a test. We are working in Lausanne on a very simple filter test that you can basically do yourself with a piece of paper and a drop of soap. So if this works, we could start to detect sickle cell easily in febrile patients. So now going to the pathogen, because this is also what you are interested. Do we always need a lab test for detecting infection? In fact, up to now, we have done not too bad using these clinical predictors. And this is another way to show you the data that Blaise showed before. For typhoid, you see the strength of association with splenomegaly, liver pain. This is a confounding factor of splenomegaly because it's correlated. So you have to cleverly combine these clinical predictors. And maybe they can do sometimes better than an average lab test. And I'm just reading right now a very nice book in the evening to get asleep. And this is about a doctor that works in Ethiopia in the 60s. And he tells in the book how he is diagnosing rickettsiosis. It's just impressive. It's by the smell. It's by looking at the patient. He knows, he has seen so many of these rickettsia cases that he's able to diagnose them on clinical grounds, and he's calling and he wants to send his data to the New England Journal of Medicine. They are quite interested because he say, I will not have a test there in Addis Ababa. So these are the symptoms and signs I have found, and he probably did quite a good job. So that's what we do, for example, in travelers, because we do not test all our travelers systematically coming back with fever for rickettsia or leptospira. What we do is we try to combine these clinical predictors. And this is the algorithm we use for travelers, so it's a bit complicated, but we combine information around chronology, exposure, did they have contact with fresh water or with animals, what type of contact with animals. We go rather in detail, duration of fever, for symptoms, for sign, we look at conjunctival suffusion, myalgia, jaundice. We combine all this to try to calculate patients that have a low probability of leptospirosis. And for these patients, we decide that we test them. They have a small probability, we do a test. For others, we consider the probability is high enough, this is a dangerous disease, we give presumptive treatment. So according to the level of probability, the potential severity of the patient in travelers, we sometimes treat presumptively. So maybe we should do the same also in the south, in endemic countries. So what would be the criteria to decide that a disease should be tested for? And here I will really concentrate on the unspecific fever. Because if we look at IMCI or even at integrated community case management, for the other infection, the algorithm is very powerful. For diarrhea, I mean, forget about antibiotics, just zinc and ORS. For fever, due to malaria, it's malaria test. I will not speak about malaria. And respiratory infections, sincerely, I think at primary care level, none of these children, at least, if they are well-nourished, need antibiotics. It's all viruses. So now for the unspecific fever. One of our criteria should be treatable with an antimicrobial treatment, because otherwise, why would we look for that disease? Or it could be that it requires a specific management. This happens for some viruses. It should be frequent enough. That's a basic concept, and probably also potentially severe. We don't care about very mild diseases. The problem here is that these two criteria can be in total opposite contradiction. What do you do when you have a very rare disease that is potentially severe? That's really a challenge. So you have three situations. You can have an endemic disease that is very rare. How to detect them? I give you an example, Crimée-Congo. Suddenly you have a patient. When you look at the description, clinical description of cases, they are never diagnosed at an early stage, only when they get severe. For this, really, we do not have a solution, I think. We could add one more band on the multiplex test. That means you will test millions of patients with fever for Crimée-Congo, and once you will have one positive. Yes, you can do that if it's not too costly to add one line on your multiplex test. But I would rather go to a severity test, because a severity test could predict us maybe early enough that this patient, whatever it is severe. Crimée-Congo, another infection, we don't care. We have to do supportive treatment. The other two difficult situations is when you have an epidemic a type of infection, but with very high seasonal, or even worse, year-to-year variation, like we saw before with Blaise. What do you do in these cases? Do you test all these patients? I will give you an example afterwards. Probably no. We should rather do surveillance as an intervention. So that means the intervention will be that temporarily, when you detect that epidemic, you add the test, you implement the test, and you remove the test when the epidemic is over. Same problem comes with diseases that are rather rare and very localized in one country, or even worse, in one area. Here again, we should do surveillance as an intervention, but not test every patient each time they come with fever. So, starting with infection, how can we avoid being looking at infection one by one? What we dream really of, what would be the basic tool to manage this patient, would be a severity test on one hand and a test to decide on antibiotic. And we are all working on that, doing trials to find tests. But here we have to keep in mind something very important. When we speak about severity test, it's about the patient. So here it makes sense to look for host biomarkers, like the group of Kevin Kane, looking at inflammatory markers, endothelial, immune, all these factors related to the host. When we look for tests to decide antibiotic, this is something different. We speak about the bacteria, and we should rather look for a pathogen biomarker. Here we have more chance to find something. You know, a small piece of the bacteria remaining in the blood, a metabolomics or transcriptomics or whatever that could tell us there is a bacteria in this blood that should not be there. But the big mistake we did up to now, and this is probably explaining the failures that we presently have to find good host biomarker to decide on antibiotics, is we mix up the two levels. We are looking at host biomarker to predict antibiotic. This is wrong. This will never work. Like some people, they think in terms of severity only about bacteria. They forget that viral disease can also be severe, and they look for pathogen biomarkers to predict severity. While here it's more about the host. So we should not mix up this level. And obviously host biomarker have a much higher chance to become sooner a rapid test than, as you can imagine, transcriptomics on a rapid test. I mean, we are far from that. So we tried to use all the samples we have collected on the febrile children to do further testing to know if we really miss big infection, because this was the question of this topic. What are we missing? And we tried to use next generation sequencing on this patient. So for those who are not familiar with this new way of diagnosing infection, like I was just before starting our project, and this is my postdoc who did this very nice animation to explain us what really is next generation sequencing. So here you have the serum or the blood of the patient, and you have a pathogenic virus that you know, dengue, chikungunya. usually what we do is we look for these viruses, but there are also other viruses around that we even don't know could potentially be pathogenic. We have other things in the blood, non-viruses, pieces of everything. We have viral debris in the blood also. We have human debris in the serum when we try to test them. And we have also mutants. So mutants are the virus, but suddenly they are slightly different. It's not the usual dengue that we are used to detect. It has mutated, and we will suddenly not detect it anymore with our conventional tests. So what we do when we do PCR, we have an assumption about what is pathogenic, and we look only for what we know. But with unbiased next-generation sequencing, we have no assumption. We look for everything, which is really the challenge, because what we detect mostly is human DNA and all this that we don't care about. So we have to do cleaning. It's a lot of work and sample preparation to be able then to find new viruses, mutants, or even debris that could help us knowing what the patient have. So for this, you need to put to detect with your sequencing machine all this information, and then you enter then in the bioinformatic pipeline. So we tested 800 samples, and we compared all what we got with a new bioinformatic bank of all known viruses for vertebrates. So it takes now, with our new bioinformatic pipeline, 1 day per sample to get the answer. And this is obviously massive data that needs then to be cleaned and analyzed. So these are the preliminary results that we just got 1 week before, where you could see what we found in 800 children in Dar es Salaam with unspecific fever. So we took out all the diarrhea, respiratory infection, all this. We took children with basically fever and nothing. What are the RNA viruses that we found mostly? So here on the right, you have the proportion of children with the virus. This is 15%. And on the right is the number of reads. So it's a sort of analogically load, if you want, of the virus. We have only viruses because NGS is presently not working for bacteria due to the human debris I told you about. So we can only look for viruses, which is obviously a huge problem. So regarding viruses, the number one was rotavirus. Interesting, these children had no diarrhea, but probably this is still around and make them sick, maybe. The second most important virus we found is a dicistrovirus. This is a completely unknown flavivirus. So this is a virus discovery. This is the example of where you discover a completely new thing, and we don't know what this is. Has been described once in human being. We've found a seasonality, so something happened in Dar es Salaam during this study. We don't know. We have obviously to look now for other cohorts to be testing to see if this will be the new Zika, if you want. Enterovirus A, this is a common virus that does fever. And for DNA viruses, the most important were the HHV6 and the parvovirus. Here you find in gray the viruses that are found. It's really our virome. You see, these are viruses that infect 100% of the children. So this is probably not pathogenic. The others could be the cause of the fever, but you know that HIV-6, as many herpesvirus, they last in the blood for several weeks or months after the acute infection. So some of these children have an old infection and some have an acute infection. If now we compare to the results we have in children in the same area with conventional tests, this is the pie chart of the fever study in the same area, it's true that the most important virus we found for this, let's say, unspecific fever, the number one was HHV6, exactly like for NGS. The second most frequent virus was parvovirus, B19. It's true that rotavirus was the most important pathogen for diarrhea, but we tested for that only in children with diarrhea, obviously. And enterovirus was found in respiratory samples, but also just in the nose in children without any respiratory symptoms. This was also one of the most frequent virus found by NGS. So there is some coherence here. These are clearly important viruses that are commensal viruses. And in this NGS data, I mean, we were a bit disappointed. Like many people who do etiologies of fever study, we found one dengue patient among 800, and that's basically all. We didn't find any chikungunya, any Zika, West Nile, Rift Valley, all these exotic things. We didn't find any. And I will show you afterwards. If you look at studies, in fact, most of them, they don't find the study in Madagascar. They found nothing. The new study in Quilombero, they did find nothing except one West Nile. So these viruses are around, but they come in epidemic. So now I will take one by one the infection that we found most frequently based on the Tanzanian data, because this is the one most detailed. But it's a bit arbitrary. If I take other studies, obviously the order in which I present you the infection would be different. So number one in children is HHV6. HHV6 is what we call in Canton de Vaud in Switzerland, la fièvre de trois jours, fever of 3 days. And this is what we tell parents. Wait 3 days before going to the pediatrician, because this is probably roseola. It's the sixth disease, like described long time ago by a pediatrician. And this gives you fever with a very faint rash that you probably miss on black skin, obviously. So if we take the criteria we had before, is this infection treatable with an antimicrobial? No specific management, no frequent enough. Yes, it's the number one. And then potentially severe, no. So only one among four criteria, probably we forget about this infection, except that it's so frequent that the advantage of having a test is that, I mean, one third of the children, we will know already that they have this mild infection, and we would stop looking for anything else. We would not give them antibiotic. That would be the only advantage of testing for that virus. Number two was parvovirus. It's the fifth disease, also very well known by pediatricians for ages, or the slap check disease, erythema infectiosum. So it gives you red checks. So again, here on black skin, probably a bit more difficult to detect. This is also generally mild, but can still do a bit of anemia. So should we test for that virus? I think we better just test for anemia. If children have serious anemia, then we have to do something, refer for transfusion, give iron, something. So probably not worth testing for that virus neither. The next most frequent infection in adults now was dengue. But what does it really mean, most frequent infection? This is due to the study of Noemi, but I tried to put on a scale, on a time scale, all fever studies that have been done in Tanzania, because this is the country that had most more studies. So starting with the very first study of Crump, he had basically zero dengue in his study, zero. He had a bit of chikungunya, but no dengue at all. In our study in children that took place just after, zero dengue again. In Boya, first month, 0.0 cases, and suddenly up to 80% of the patient had dengue. And then another study in Quilombero, so exactly the same place we had worked, again zero. And for the last study where we did NGS, we found one case. So here you have to put a small beep. But what should we do here in Africa for dengue? Asia is different. Asia, you have dengue all the time. But in Africa, should we really test all these patients during 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years with having zero cases, and then suddenly you have an epidemic? It's clear that this disease has several criteria to be tested for. It's frequent, it can be potentially severe, obviously, and it requires a specific management. In travelers, when we know they have dengue, we will look at them very differently. So it's probably useful from a clinical point of view to know that the patient has dengue. But in Africa, we cannot afford to test them all the time. So we should really do what we discussed before, targeted surveillance in sentinel sites. And when I say targeted, is again, if you do surveillance by taking consecutive patients, you will find zero, then it's zero, then it's zero, then everybody gets tired. So you rather go for a syndrome, like they do in Senegal. They have a syndromic surveillance where they take all patients, if they have fever, clear myalgia, maybe a rash, then you look for dengue in sentinel sites, and you have no cases. Suddenly you detect a few cases, and then you know something is going on, and you can decide to put temporarily the test in the health facilities for patient management. Next most frequent infection, UTI. For children, it's an unspecific fever because they usually do not complain of any symptoms, and it's treatable and frequent. What should we do here? For adults, they are supposed to have symptoms and signs, so this is a bit out of the undifferentiated fever. We should test them for with urine dipstick only when they have complaints, and also probably in pregnant women. For children, we saw before that it is really age-dependent. It's young children with nappies, basically. So in our algorithm, what we do is when we have found no cause of the fever and the child is less than 2 years of age, we test for urine dipstick to look for UTI. But still, we are not fully convinced that it is useful. This is what we found when we retrospectively did urine culture in these febrile children. So we had two arms, one arm that was managed with an algorithm not based on urine dipstick, but based on CRP and procalcitonin to decide about antibiotics. So looking at these 13 children with a real urinary infection, we found out that we had, in fact, detected four of them with our CRP and PCT. Not too bad. They were all cured. But for those that we had missed and given no antibiotic, they were also cured. So what? And in Almanac, we were rather using urine dipstick. And here again, you see, they were all cured. They were all tested and treated for urinary tract infection. But in fact, in this arm, one did not cure, although we treated. So the picture is really unclear because urine dipstick is not such a good test. Which children are really at risk of doing a bacteremia or a serious complication of UTI? We do not really know. We do not have a good test. Next most frequent infection, typhoid. And this is valid for adults and children. These have three criteria among the four. So what should we do in adults? Probably blood culture still. We are left with blood culture because PCR is not sensitive enough, clearly. And also because bacteremia is one of the next most frequent infections in adults, but mainly adults that are admitted. So blood culture, we are still there for admitted adults. For children, we would like to test for typhoid before they are admitted. Should we use the rapid test in the subgroup of patients that have abdominal tenderness? I think it's worse. I mean, we have a test that is not too bad, 80% sensitivity and specificity. I think we should use them, especially when there is an epidemic. It's done in Asia. Why should we not try in Africa, maybe based on surveillance again? For bacteremia, should all these children have blood culture? We have seen very few are positive. And again, when we retrospectively looked at the blood culture data in the EPOCT study, we could see that some of them we treated because based on CRP, it was high, we treated them. But two had a low CRP, were still bacteremic. We didn't treat them. Nothing happened to them. Same in Almanac. So they are able, when they have a good immune system, to get rid of this bacterial infection by themselves. It's only when they are malnourished or other problems that they might die. And then we enter in infections that are much less prevalent, that are between 1 and 2%. So the next one was syphilis and acute HIV seroconversion, where the next two most frequent infections in adults. And they have a lot of green ticks for deciding that they might be useful testing for. I would say that in febrile adults, they should all be tested with, for HIV, this is obvious, and probably also for syphilis. We have very good rapid tests. Why not use them much more? And the next most frequent infection were CMV in EBV, both in children and adults. In fact, at least in Tanzania, CMV is young children are getting the infection for the first time, while EBV is more an infection of adolescents, young children, older children and adolescents. But you see, they have not much criteria to be tested for. So I would say these two, we don't really care. We don't need to test for them. While for rickettsia, obviously, found both in children and adults at a rate of 1%, what should we do? Three criteria. We have no good test for the acute phase. PCR is not sensitive enough. Serology becomes positive only after 4 weeks. So we should do like we do in travelers. We combine predictors based on exposure, symptoms, and signs, and then we test the patient, or we even treat presumptively. We test when we do PCR on skin. That's the only thing we have. If we do not have that, we presumptively give doxycycline in these patients. Should we do the same for a very well-defined subgroup of patients with positive predictors? Lepto is, according to the places, slightly more frequent, slightly less frequent than rickettsia, has two criteria. Here we have a rapid test, so should we use it much more? Again, in subgroup of patients with a specific exposure that we know have contacts with animals that are taking the milk from the cow and things like that, probably. And the next most frequent were all diseases related to HIV. So you have the fungus, you have the disseminated TB, all these things that are really serious, but found only in immunosuppressed patients with CD4 count less than 200. So we need this point of care CD4 count test. And from there, we can go to LAM, like David was mentioning. Finally, chikungunya, very epidemic. So this is a bit like for dengue in Africa, targeted surveillance in sentinel sites. And for Zika, it's a problem only for pregnant women. For the other patient, we really don't care. So should it be surveillance? Should we still do a pregnancy test in all febrile women? And if positive, then tests for Zika. We will soon probably have a rapid test. But here again, why test a male for Zika, except if his wife is pregnant, obviously? So if I try to summarize all this, it's not easy. I would just want to emphasize that this basic test of overall management of patients are the most important, much more important than the pathogen-specific test. And the number one would be the severity test that we desperately need, and a test to decide of antibiotics, but this will take probably a long time before we get that. In the meantime, we have things to look at: anemia, respiratory distress, hypoglycemia, and comorbidities. The most important is this malnutrition, failure to thrive, HIV, and sickle cell. On the side of pathogen, diseases requiring immediate testing if we have enough money, mostly at hospital level, probably not so much at peripheral level, would be this list. So malaria and typhoid, obviously, these are the two most important, probably. UTI only in a subgroup of patients. Dengue in Asia in all patients. HIV and syphilis in adults. Common bacteremia only when admitted. Rickettsia, leptospira only in targeted adults. We found no infection in children. And Zika in pregnant women. And diseases that should rather go for surveillance and not for immediate patient-level management is dengue in Africa, chikungunya probably everywhere, Ebola, Marburg, these more epidemic diseases, yellow fever. And there are diseases for which we really don't know what to do at all. It's Lassa, Crimean Congo, plague, for example. They are endemic. One case here and there. How can we deal with that? No idea. So the future is this combination of patient-level management where we have algorithms with this sensor to look for oxygen, respiratory distress, anemia, point-of-care tests only for the few pathogens we discussed now, We send all the data to a central server, we analyze it, we do syndromic surveillance, and we have a few sentinel sites with a surveillance platform to feed the system with information that could tell us that we have to go back to the health facility, update the algorithm, add a test to change management of patient. And obviously, disease control measures are essential for most of these diseases, not so much about management, but rather preventive measure in the community. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Valerie. That's an excellent talk. We have overrun quite a bit, so perhaps if we can take one or two questions, and I will then urge the speakers to stick around in the coffee break. If there's any other questions, do come see them.
Yes, Valerie, you mentioned malaria tests, and it's clear malaria, but in MSL, what we found, that especially in the hospitals, is around 60% of these patients with complicated malaria are receiving antibiotics, anti-malarias and antibiotics. So my question is, what is your opinion about co-infection and management with antibiotics cases of complicated malaria?
So my presentation was really focused on primary care level, because this is where we have this tension about should we give an antibiotic or not. As soon as the patient is admitted with severe disease, the story becomes different, because here you have no more the question of antibiotic pressure. This is very few patients. And what happens presently is that they do not get antibiotic because clinicians want to prove the diagnosis. So they wait for the chest X-ray that never comes to document pneumonia before giving the antibiotic, while they would treat presumptively at primary care level. So it's exactly the reverse that should be done. And in severe malaria, there is a WHO recommendation for children to always get antibiotics, give antibiotics with the antimalarial. For adults, it's less clear. We would prefer to have some investigation, but if it's not available, probably to also give an antibiotic is a good idea.
Yeah, so maybe it's just a comment. I think on the NGS, it's a very good approach for viruses where you have a high viral load. But I think probably with the arboviruses, so usually when we are in the hospital, we would not maybe test for the virus, but do a serology. So probably this is also something where the lab facilities could do more in terms of offering serological tests, because we know, for example, West Nile or Zika, they have a very low viral load. And when we do NGS, we are not so sensitive, like with a specific PCR. So probably they are there, but we don't find them. So I think it's would be, I mean, it's a question if it's doable, but in many settings, it might be feasible to rather do a serology than a NGS testing.
Yeah. So Isabella, who is part of the group of Laurent Kaiser in Geneva, head of the Emerging Viral Disease Center, they have done all these analyses that I have shown you for the causes of fever, and these are the group who did recently the NGS. And when I asked Laurent about his take-home message from this data, he said, you see, Valerie, probably we missed a step, the conventional test. We went directly for and bias NGS, but we miss things, like you are saying. We miss dengue cases because we don't test for IgM. So we worked with the Gates Foundation to find a broad serological platform. And we sent our samples to these new groups that are supposed to have found something. In fact, it doesn't work for now. So we have to wait a bit. But this would be essential to complement. And the other thing, we need something for bacteria. So we have these two big pieces that we miss, because obviously the dream would be that the surveillance could be done just by an NGS platform. But for now, it seems not to be.
Yes, I don't understand why you said that with NGS, it's not possible to detect bacteria in blood.
Isabella, can you help me to explain that?
Well, I mean, the problem is that you don't get, first of all, you get a lot of reads, and then it's also a bioinformatic problem to really sort this out. So you have, with bacteria, you have even more background than you have, for example, for the viruses. And then you have a very large genome, so you don't always have the whole coverage of the pathogen. And to really distinguish which type of pathogen it is, it's still a problem also of the database for the bacteria. So it also, when you go to the bioinformatic, it gets much, much more complicated for the bacteria.
But I think starting with the sample preparation, you can improve. If you remove all the DNA from human, you can make an enrichment step to focus after that on pathogens, bacteria, or viruses.
That's what we did for the viruses already. We worked a lot on the enrichment. We even connected with group in United States to compare if their enrichment method was better than ours. And in fact, we were slightly better. So for bacteria, nobody could propose as a solution in practice.
I think the NGS, I mean, there were lots of high expectations when the method was introduced, but it is recognized now that it's not the magic bullet where you put your sample in and you get a diagnosis out. So it's still very difficult from all these reads to really say, okay, this is the pathogen that makes the patients ill, because you have this whole cloud of sequences, and it also takes a lot of computer power, but it's still very far from a diagnostic tool. We know it's not so sensitive, and then many times we have findings and we don't really know what it means. So it's very different to when you take a swab and you culture something, you can do a resistance testing. So it's still very far from a diagnostic tool.
We'll take one last quick question, I hope.
Yeah. Yes, thank you very much for the two presentations, very good. Just some thoughts about this. I agree with you when you say that we don't need to test for everything to know like what you're circulating, etc. For example, in Brazil, sometimes the public health laboratory, they test in just one state 100,000 samples for IgM for dengue. We don't need to test 100,000 to know that dengue is circulating, of course. Mm-hmm. So, you know. But at the same time, when we look at the picture in the past, where the antibiotics were given a lot to the population, one of the reasons is because for the pediatrician, for example, was very difficult to attend the child in an emergency with dyspnea that probably was due to RSV, and send the children back home, and he knows that the child will not return because the mother do not have money to pay the bus or the train next day if she needed. So he preferred to give the antibiotics. Mm-hmm. So we came to that, the first presentation, that wrong dosage and the wrong way to use, et cetera, et cetera. And I think that now we are improving all these aspects when we have the family doctors, because one thing essential is to have the follow-up of mm-hmm. this child and their family, because I think that is a little bit easy to say, oh, we don't need to test everybody, we don't need this, we don't need that, but we need to have a follow-up mm-hmm. of that child. Yeah. Do you know, we need to have public health units available near their homes. And this is something absolutely essential when we think in public health policies to give a better answer to each patient. So it's just one thing that sometimes I think that I miss in some presentations is that what you do for the patient, because if the child is not severe in that day when mm-hmm. we collect the sample, she can be next day. And so probably she will not find a hospital or something nearby to go. No?
Okay. On that note, I'd like to thank our speakers again. Valerie Blair's great talks. See you back here. We'll make that 10 past 10. So slightly extended coffee break.